We need a go, no go for recording the podcast.
Audacity, go. Hijack, go. FaceTime, go. Show notes, go. Roger that, we are go for launch.
I hear you went to a balloon festival of some sort.
I went to a balloon festival, the Bristol International Balloon Fiesta.
Oh, a balloon fiesta? That sounds even better than a festival.
I don't think that's like them being silly. I think that's what you call a balloon fiesta. Oh, I think that's what you call a balloon festival. I think that's like the acknowledged name, like the collective noun, maybe. A fiesta of balloons.
Oh, yeah?
What is the collective noun for hot air balloons? I'm checking.
What's
there's our first Google search of the podcast.
Boy, we are, what, 15 seconds in, and already there is some Brady keyboard typing that I'm going to be cutting out.
Collective noun for hot air balloons. A drift of hot air balloons, according to one person. Then there's some...
I am shocked.
Oh, no, hang on. There's all sorts of things here. There's some silly ones here, so I think some of these aren't even true.
I don't really believe most of these collective noun.
Yeah, I think things. This is just people making up words, and you know how we feel about people making up words.
It's delightful is how we feel about it.
It's
sometimes anyway.
A freeboot of hot air balloons.
A freeboot of infringements, that's what it would be.
A freeboot of infringements. Yeah. So I did go to the Bristol International Balloon Fiesta for a day and got a special VIP parking pass. I got to go into the balloonist car park, which got me, not only did it get me really close to the action, but it also meant you could get out really easily, which is very handy because 200,000 people went to go and watch these balloons. And getting out for civilians is an absolute nightmare, like hours and hours it takes to get out. But I went straight out the emergency road with all the vans that are chasing the balloons. So I had a much better experience than the average Joe.
I'm going to be honest here. You told me you went to this hot air balloon fiesta. What I had in my mind was some little local event with a few hobbyist hot air balloonists, I guess. But 200,000 people, that's a serious number of people.
It's the real deal. It's the real deal. I mean, I went to every morning and evening throughout the event, which goes for 3 or 4 days. They do these mass ascents where a whole bunch of balloons all sort of take off together. And I reckon 60 or 70 must have gone for mine. I made a video. I sent it to you. I mean, you saw the video and that's just some of the balloons going up. It's a big thing. You're Googling images.
What I was Googling for, actually, I was thinking, how big are balloon festivals? Because the only one I know off the top of my head is the one that happens in New Mexico every year.
Yeah, I mean, that's the granddaddy of them all, isn't it? That's
This is why I was thinking that's going to be my scale of comparison here, because I think that's the biggest one.
Mm.
And I don't see numbers of people, but numbers of balloons is 500 at the New Mexico one. So you figure the one that you went to is just slightly less than half as big as the biggest. That's pretty impressive. And it's in your backyard.
I mean, Bristol is one of the world capitals of hot air ballooning. The biggest hot air balloon company in the world is based here and a couple of other ones. It's a hotbed of hot air ballooning here at Bristol. And quite often in the evening, you'll just see one or two flying each night if the weather's good. But this is quite a sight when the fiesta's on. And you'll see, like, I was driving home one of the other days along the motorway and I just looked out to the left and you just see dozens and dozens and dozens of balloons just like zooming past. It's quite amazing.
The idea of just on a normal day looking up in the sky and seeing a hot air balloon floating along doing its little thing, that sounds delightful. That sounds like a really nice thing to randomly see in the sky. Just a happy little hot air balloon floating along.
I have a real special relationship with hot air balloons too. Over the years, I've through some films I made, which I don't even know if you know about, but there was a scientist at the University of Nottingham who in her spare time was this amazing world record hot air balloonist who did all these amazing things. And she talked the university into buying her a hot air balloon and it became the University of Nottingham hot air balloon with all the branding all over it. And I sort of followed her through the journey of having it made. And I actually went on its first flight over the Swiss Alps and things like that. So I had this like quite long-standing relationship with balloons and this particular balloonist who really sadly actually then died. She got cancer and died, which was really, really sad. But she always was a really, really amazing lady. And making these videos with her was one of the real privileges of my life. And I still can't see a hot air balloon without thinking of her. Her name was Janet Folkes, and she was an amazing woman. But because of her, I have this real love and interest in hot air balloons. So when I moved to Bristol, it was great. I was thinking, oh, I can go to this balloon fiesta. And for the first couple of years I was here, for some reason, I just never went. But this time I finally went. I went to the mass ascent. I took lots of photos, made lots of videos. It was great. It was really good. I'll definitely be going again.
Yeah, you're going to become a regular?
Yeah. I have learned you spend a lot of time waiting around when you follow hot air balloons and do things with hot air balloons. There is a lot of downtime.
Yeah. Well, I noticed the footage on the video that you sent me is sped up in many places.
Yes.
Because yeah. Balloons are very slow and very, very just gentle manatees of the air, as it were.
They are like
swimming along.
Would you go in one?
No, never. No. Never. I get a queasy feeling in my feet just thinking about being in a hot air balloon over the Alps.
You feel surprisingly safe in them, I find.
The walls of the basket are relatively high?
Yeah, you never feel like you're going to fall out or anything. Although I have to say, I did one of the other events I went to with Janet was this balloon. It's called the Gordon Bennett Balloon Race. And this is actually different balloons. This is, they fill balloons up with hydrogen. This isn't hot air. They fill them up with hydrogen and then they just all take off on a race. And in this case, they just all went across Europe. And whoever goes the furthest before they have to land wins. And obviously, you can't top up the hydrogen. You can only just let off weight. So that's how the race works, you see. And it's almost a bit of a blinking contest. It's, you know, who's going to blink first? And they all just go for it. And Janet broke a world record on one of them for women balloonists. Her and another woman broke the distance record for women. But on this particular one I went to, I went and waited and I watched them all leave, which was an amazing sight. I made a video of it. I'll put some links in the show notes for people who want to watch these. But on that particular race, one of the balloons went missing and the people in it died. They got into a storm and couldn't get out and plunged into the ocean. So it's not without risk. And of course, everyone's always seen these famous videos of the ones that catch fire, and it's not good PR for balloons. But I think they're pretty safe.
I'm very surprised to hear you say that there are still balloons that use hydrogen, because of course, the only thing I can think of is the Hindenburg. I thought, oh, didn't we stop with the hydrogen at that point?
This is quite specialized. This isn't like touristy stuff. This is a very special race for the pros, you know. Cool race.
Still, though, a gigantic sack of hydrogen. Wouldn't want to be in a lightning storm flying in one of those.
No, they think that's what happened to those people who died, but I don't know how it was resolved.
Would they do balloons on air crash investigation? Does somebody write up a whatever it is, the PCRB reports that you like so much?
I'm sure that, I don't know. I've never read a hot air balloon crash investigation report, but I'm sure the NTSB does investigate them. So
yeah, it's aviation, right? Someone has to write a report.
I imagine it's them. I don't know for sure.
You've never seen a hot air balloon on air crash investigators?
I don't believe I have. One thing that I did want to talk to you about from all of this is it did occur to me while I was watching all these balloons taking off and 200,000 people watching, absolutely captivated, and I think probably 90% of them taking photos. What a fabulous advertising billboard hot air balloons are. I think they're a great way to advertise. Most of them, I think, are sponsored by companies. Smart hot air balloonists get some company to pay for the balloon and have their name on it, and they've got a toy to play with for the next 5 years, and the company's got a big flying advert for the next 5 years. But I think they're a wonderful advert or public relations machines, hot air balloons, because who doesn't love them? There's nothing but goodwill towards them. Everyone loves, whether you're scared of going in them or not, everyone loves a hot air balloon.
That's exactly what I said before. To see one in the sky, it makes you smile.
Yeah.
And then you think of Bob's Burger Joint, who's also helped make that thing fly.
Exactly. I mean, it was a genius public relations move by the University of Nottingham to give Janet the money for her balloon, because she traveled all around the world with it. You know, there it was flying over the Swiss Alps. In fact, on that first few days it flew, I took a photograph of it flying over the Swiss Alps just with my normal camera. And I'm no award-winning photographer, but when you've got a hot air balloon in mountains, you almost can't go wrong. And I took this photo and thought nothing of it. And a couple of years later, I was in the office of the vice chancellor of the university, and there's a huge framed picture of the balloon flying over the mountains, and I was in the waiting room waiting to meet him, and I was like, that's bloody my photo. I don't know how it ended up with him. I don't know who got it. I obviously gave it to the university to use, and it got blown up to the sort of the size of a window and framed.
I was going to say, you didn't burst into his office and accuse him of copyright infringement. Yeah, that wasn't your next action.
No, no. The University of Nottingham are good people. But it was quite amazing. I'm sitting there looking at it, and I'm like, that's my photo. Amazing. But the reason I make the point is that it shows what wonderful public relations things they are, that with all the great things these big universities do, the boss of the whole uni, the thing that he mm-hmm. wants to have up on the wall is this hot air balloon. Mm-hmm. Everyone loves hot air balloons.
Yeah, it's impressive and it's fun. Although I wonder what the rates are for advertising on hot air balloons.
I mean, I don't think they're interchangeable like that. I think, you know, the envelope, as it's called, the balloon itself, mm-hmm. is a pretty permanent thing. I don't think you can chop and change the advert. So I think it's a one-off, isn't it? I mean, one of the problems for hot air balloons is they're not clickable.
That's one of the weird things in the world of advertising, is precisely these brand moments. Mm. So you can definitely say that the University of Nottingham, for example, gets a lot of friendly PR and a lot of recognition from people around the world from seeing the University of Nottingham on the balloon. But yes, you can't track it like we do with our advertisements, where there's a code that the advertisers know then exactly, like, oh, what's the return on investment for advertising on various things. You never have any idea what the return on investment for advertising on a hot air balloon is, or even just regular old billboard advertising. It's very hard to have any idea about how much is that worth in terms of just a raw ROI calculation.
I mean, you're right. It must be a nightmare to measure, but it's still a mm-hmm. very real thing and a very important mm-hmm. thing.
That happiness that people feel is real, but it is impossible to put a number on. How much should we spend on hot air balloons this year?
Yeah. It's not only the happiness that's real, though. Like, it does convert into stuff. I mean, there's no better example than the videos I make with the University of Nottingham, and I now go to the university, as I've said to you before, and I'll walk around there now because I've been doing this way too long. Lots mm-hmm. of people will come up to me and say, oh, you're that Brady guy. Do you know, I go to this university because of those videos. I watched them when I was at school and I really love them, and therefore I chose the University of Nottingham. And you can't measure that, and the university probably doesn't know how many people are there for that reason, or how many people are there because they once saw the balloon, and they probably never will know that. But it was still money well spent or time well spent. So
that has to be very strange for you to know that there are students at the university directly because of your work. I feel like that's a very one-to-one relationship between you make videos and people make changes in the whole rest of their life based on those videos.
I don't know if it's one-to-one, because obviously there are really amazing people in my videos and a lot of other people involved in them. It's not just me who makes them. But in terms of that video to the person relationship, it is amazing. I always joke with people who say that. I say, don't make any decisions based on me. Mm-hmm. I don't know where the cheese grater is in my house, let alone what mm-hmm. university you should go to. But but go to the University of Nottingham if you're unsure.
Yes. And when they say, where did you hear about us? You write down Brady's videos.
Brady Haran. I'd love a big grey balloon with HI on it and the big dotted square around it. How cool would that be?
I think that would look really good on a balloon. That would be quite striking.
I wonder if grey is like an illegal colour for a balloon, or one you shouldn't use because it like merges into the sky and it becomes a hazard. Because I can't think of many grey hot air balloons I've seen over the years, and I've seen quite a few. Mm. There might be a law against grey balloons.
I wonder. Maybe you could put blinking lights around it. You could get around that. Mm. The dots could blink.
The hot air balloon you would have loved that was being tested at this particular fiesta was a solar-powered hot air balloon. And basically, it was pretty much mostly black, mm-hmm. and so it could absorb all the heat to heat up the air, to keep it in the air.
Oh, clever.
And you would have loved how it looked. It was like a kind of, I don't know, it just looked cool. It looked badass.
Did you get a picture of it?
I didn't see it the day I was there, but I've seen some video of it, so we'll dig some pictures up to show people. It was made by Cameron Balloons, I believe, if you're doing a search for it.
I am. You can't tell when I'm typing now because I don't have my clicky keyboard.
Oh, no, I can tell. Don't worry.
Oh yeah, you can still tell.
Big time.
Oh, okay. I see this one. I see this one. Yeah. So it has cool. it has the stripe. It's asymmetrical a little bit, black on one side, white on the other.
It's cool looking.
It is very cool looking. It's very cool looking. Interesting.
It does have burners on board in case of, you know, the sun getting blocked and things. By law, it has to have burners as well to heat up the air.
It has burners on board in case of clouds. I certainly would hope so.
Yeah.
Even the world of hot air balloons has technological progress within it.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Let's move on from hot air balloons. What do we got in the follow-up list here? Let me have a look.
I think you wanted to talk about how wrong I was on the internet.
You were wrong on the internet. I mean, surely you should know by now. You should never state something as a fact on the podcast because everyone right. will immediately go and look. And if it is not a fact...
You're going to hear about it. But again, this I thought was funny. We're talking now about the neutral video that we mentioned offhandedly last time as having the same number of thumbs up and thumbs down.
Yeah.
And this has been an interesting experience because, again, my Twitter feed is filled with nothing but pictures that are all the thumbnail of that image of the guy in the Futurama clip and then someone circling below at the number of thumbs up or thumbs down being slightly off.
Yeah.
And the thing that's interesting to me about this is I feel, oh, okay, I make these YouTube videos that lots of people watch and I will have little errors in those videos and I hear way less about errors in my videos now than I do an offhanded remark, which I'm clearly not even backing on the podcast. I said, like, I was just speculating idly that maybe this was hard-coded into YouTube because I'd never seen it be different. And holy God, have I heard from people about how it's different. So it does seem that your speculation is correct, that it is community-powered and not hard-coded, which is impressive because there are many of these videos around YouTube, and it seems that almost all of them are within five or so always of being the same on thumbs up and thumbs down.
Gray, nerds are diligent.
Nerds are diligent. There are probably a few people watching them with OCD, making sure to keep it even as much as possible.
Yeah. So another little piece of follow-up was something I forgot to tell you about, which was a nice little story. Let's talk about airports for a second.
Okay.
You were having a moan about your airport you hate so much, Dulles.
I do love a good moan about an airport.
Yeah, especially Dulles.
Yeah. I do love a good moan about Dulles is actually what I'm saying.
Yeah.
There are many nice airports that I travel through about which I say nothing, but I will talk endlessly about Dulles, which I hate.
I wonder if like the head of publicity and public relations at Dulles Airport gets like a chill down their spine every time a new Hello Internet is released.
Yeah, he has a Google alert out that searches the Hello Internet page for mentions of Dulles to know if he needs to go into PR damage mode.
Yeah.
I didn't even talk last time about the birds that were flying from Dulles. It was just like, oh, there's too much to complain about. I can't even mention everything that happens every time I go.
They're in a committee meeting right now saying, how much are we going to pay this gray guy to shut him up? Today's episode is brought to you by... Brady, you're going to have to read this one.
Dulles Airport, I will not accept your advertising dollars. If Dulles Airport wants to give us money for a PR spot, you would have to read that one, I think. And I'd charge them double.
You'd take the money, you just wouldn't do the read.
Yeah, I think maybe that would even be better.
Let me tell you about an airport. Well, actually, it is kind of a problem for the airport, but it wasn't a problem for me, and it became a wonderful experience.
Okay.
When I arrived at Marrakesh a few weeks back now, we sat at the front of the plane, so we got off first and we got to the passport control first. And there were lots of people standing around, as there often are at these airports in exotic countries, the culture of which I don't understand. Lots of people standing around, none of them seemed to be doing any work, except for one guy who was stamping passports. And because we were at the front of the queue, we got straight through. We were first ones through, absolute breeze. And I think behind us, there must have been some family of 18 people who all wanted to go through together and half of them didn't have their passports or something. Because whatever happened, we went through and then there was a long, long, long time before anyone else was going to get through. And I was waiting at the luggage carousel with my wife and all the bags started coming out. And obviously there was no one to take them. We were the only people in the baggage hall. We were the only people. The place was completely empty. It was amazing. It was huge, huge area, just two of us. The carousel filled up with all the bags that it could take.
Right.
And because there was no one to take them away, that was it. So So they couldn't put any more bags on the carousel. So we were just standing there watching the same bags going past, not our bags, thinking, well, we're going to be stuck here now until everyone else gets through passport control and creates some more room on the carousel. And there was still no one through. 15, 20 minutes, not a single soul had come through.
Okay, this is getting suspicious.
Yeah, it was a bit. So anyway, I mean,
how big was this plane? How far ahead were you?
It was an EasyJet plane. Everyone was in the queue. The next people behind us were standing right behind us. Everyone was standing behind us. There was obviously something.
But I guess what I'm trying to figure out is, were you on a plane with nothing but the sketchiest looking people, yeah, all of whom need interviews through customs when they arrive? Like, how on earth can you be the only people?
I don't know, Gray, but I promise I'm telling you the truth. So it got to the point where I was edging closer and closer to the little hole where all the bags come out that leads to the outside. Mm-hmm. And I started like poking my head through to see if there were other bags waiting. And around the same time, this Moroccan man poked his head through to see what was going on and why none of the bags were moving. Mm-hmm. So we kind of met eyes, and he looked into the hole and saw that I was the only person there. And he straight away knew what the problem was. And I said, I'm trying to get my bag. And I could see all these trolleys parked on the tarmac outside with all these bags on it. And he said, which one? Which one is yours? So I ended up sort of pointing, and he walked over to the trolley, and I was like hanging my head through the hole over the conveyor belt saying, see that black one under those two red ones to the right of that blue one? And he's like, this one here? And I'm like, yeah, yeah. And he pulled that one out, and then I found my wife's and said, yeah, that one, that second one up on the other trolley. No, 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 not that one. That one. No, no, below that one. This one, yes. And he sort of pulled it out like a Jenga piece, and all the other bags came toppling down, and he got our two bags, and then he physically passed them through the hole to me, like handed them to me hand to hand. It was brilliant. And there was still
no valet service.
It was valet. And I slipped him some money. Like, I tipped him. I was like, thanks, man. You saved me a lot of pain. And then we went off through and got our cab and got our car that was waiting for us. Still no one had come through. So I would have been there forever waiting for those other people if it wasn't for that nice man at Marrakesh Airport. So spend those $2 wisely, my friend. That's all I had on me. I only had $2 on me. I felt guilty, but it was all I had in my pocket. There you go. Marrakesh Airport, thumbs up.
Yeah. Thumbs up for their valet luggage service.
Thumbs down for their passport control if you're not the first two people in the line, though.
I'm very glad that your bags came through and that you had this nice little valet experience. That's nice and all. But my mind just keeps focusing on, where were all the other people? That's the part of the story that I keep wanting to go back to. This feels like a mystery.
Yeah, don't know. You don't think about who's behind you, Gray. You crack on.
You walk fast to that passport control.
Yep.
You hope, right, there's nothing but a bunch of children and slow old ladies in front of you that you can stride on by as fast as possible without actually breaking into a run so you look like a jerk. It's like, oh no, I'm just walking fast, trying to get past everybody. Because if you're at the back of those big passport lines, forget it.
The toilet can wait.
That is a terrible time to say, oh, let me just go to the bathroom. And then you're behind 600 people.
The toilet is not an option.
This does just remind me that I made a little note about something on my last flight where I wanted to tell you that you were correct about something.
Wow.
I know you like this.
Wow. Yes. Brady is correct about something corner.
We had a disagreement a while back about whether or not the self-checkout machines in the grocery stores are faster or not.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember this?
Yes.
Yeah. Don't get excited because I'm not going to tell you that you're right there. You're totally wrong.
Okay.
However, I'm pretty sure I made some broad sweeping statement about how, oh, using the machines are always faster. Let me tell you, I ran into a machine while traveling where all I could think of was I was just shaking my little fist thinking, Brady is right. This machine is terrible. And it was at Dulles Airport when I was going through customs. The United States has the equivalent of the grocery checkout machines for going through U.S. customs if you are a U.S. citizen.
Is this customs or passport control, like immigration?
I mean where they're checking your passport and seeing if they're going to let you into the country.
Well, you know they have that at most U.K. airports now as well.
Here's the details about these machines.
Yeah.
I'd never seen them before, and I walk up and I go, oh, okay. Well, I'm sure this is going to be great. A nice little automated machine. It certainly is going to speed up the line. No, it's not going to speed up the line. I have never seen a machine designed like this, but you are required to scan your passport And I was standing there watching everybody else trying to scan their passport. And I'm trying to scan my passport. And the little machine goes, right? It keeps buzzing at me saying it's not scanning the passport correctly. And I'm looking around and I see maybe the 20 other people who are also using these machines. Everybody is having a hard time scanning these little passports.
Yeah.
Something, what's going on? But I was determined, I'm going to figure out this machine. I'm not going to ask the nice lady for help. I'm going to figure this out. The design of this passport scanner was that you have to hold your passport, stick it in this little tunnel, basically, for the scanner. You have to put your hand all the way in, and inside the tunnel where you cannot see your hand, much like those secret voting boxes that we were talking about on our special episode, inside there, there's a little lever that you have to reach for with your hand that you can't see to pull down. And it pulls down some scanner on top of your passport. But you have to do it physically with your hand. Otherwise, the machine will not scan the passport.
Okay, that is a little bit more, that is weird.
And I thought, this is the craziest self-automated machine I have ever seen. And it did work. I pulled down the little lever so that it eventually scans my passport. It puts everything up on the screen and I confirm, oh, yes, this is me. Here are the reasons that I'm coming in, blah, blah, blah. And of course, because it's the United States, the machine also takes a little picture of you because I'm sure it's going into a gigantic database somewhere, you know, who knows where, but somewhere, you know, that goes into this database. And so this machine was just taking everybody a really long time, but I figured, oh, okay. At least I figured it out. I can make it happen really fast this next time. Next time I use it, it'll be great. But no, it gives you the little ticket and then you just get in the line totally as normal. Then you still have to talk to the regular guy who asks you all the regular questions. You just show him that you did the little auto scan of your receipt, but he also scans your passport. It was just, again, an astounding example of this like bizarre airport inefficiency. It's like, great, this machine takes longer and I still have to do all the normal things. Anyway.
Oh, great. We could do a whole podcast about how I feel about those self-passport machines. They are. When I came back into Bristol just the other day, there were 40 or 50 people waiting in like the human flesh line, and there were five or six people in the robo line. And so I got into the robo line, and the woman there who was like shepherding people through just looked at me and shook her head and said, seriously, it'll be quicker over there. And I just nodded and walked away. I was like, I hear you, sister. I hear you.
That's the person to trust.
I mean, the British ones are not as stupid as that, what you just said, with all these little levers and that. And they're reasonably simple to use. I can use them. But I swear they must have some kind of brain-zapping laser, because as soon as people walk into them, they become completely incompetent human beings, incapable of doing basic procedures. And I just stand there watching them going, oh, for goodness sake, I just want to go and yank the passport out of their hand and say, put it here, look there, step there, get out of my way. Crazy.
The thing that really impressed me about these ones for the US Customs was I have already scanned my passport earlier at the airport at a different machine which didn't have this mechanism. I have scanned my passport at many airports that don't have this mechanism, and almost everybody who's on this plane with me has certainly done the same thing. Why on earth would you make the situation different for the second time for almost everybody who's getting off the plane, right? Because everybody who's boarded that plane scanned their passport in one way when they were getting their tickets, and now you introduce this new, more complicated thing at the end of the flight that they have to scan. It was just like, hey, whoever made these machines, buy the scanners that were made by that other company. And then it will be at least be consistent. You give people a fighting chance.
Might cost $100 more per machine though or something. So
it may be, but I was looking at those machines and I'm looking at everybody struggling through them. And I thought, there is no way this is clearing the line faster. My suspicion is that the whole purpose of that machine is actually the part where it takes your photo. I thought, this is why they're doing this. Is to build some gigantic database. It's not at all about making the line any faster.
They take your photo when you go through the flesh lane as well, though. You have to look into the little camera and they take your picture.
They have never done that if you are a US citizen before.
No, okay, right.
So it used to always be, oh, we only take pictures of dirty foreigners. But now it's, oh, we also take pictures of dirty Americans. Trust nobody.
They take my photo, all my fingerprints, and then give me a 20-minute interview about YouTube videos.
Air travel, always fun. We have a new sponsor for this episode of Hello Internet, and that is JustWorks. If you have a small business, then JustWorks is for you. JustWorks.com helps you run payroll, fill out W-2s, negotiate healthcare prices. As a small business owner, these are all things that you have to do, but they take away time from you focusing on the core of your work. Let JustWorks take care of that for you. JustWorks will process your payroll automatically, set up your team's benefits online, and help you save on healthcare. It's just that simple. If you go to JustWorks.com, you can see examples of their clean-looking software to help you manage benefits, your payroll, your HR tools, a company dashboard, and compliance. So if you are running a small business and you feel overwhelmed by the amount of busy paperwork that you have to do, which isn't really the core of your business, go check out JustWorks.com. And when you go there, use the offer code HELLOINTERNET for 10% off your first year. This saves you money and lets JustWorks know that you came from our podcast. JustWorks.com helps you take care of your small business and your team.
I just want to very quickly do my new favorite thing, which I know you don't like. I'm quickly going to give people an update on where the two Hello Internet flagships are as we record.
Mm-hmm.
We are the only podcast in the world that has official flagships.
But they're not official flagships.
They're not official flagships.
There's nothing official about them.
They're unofficial flagships. They're like mascots. They're mascot ships of Hello Internet. I, of course, am talking about Anthem of the Seas, currently sailing off the coast of Spain towards Southampton. It's coming to England, Gray.
Oh, wow. Are you going to go meet it?
Do you know what? I'd like to, because I looked a little bit up about where it's going to be over the next year or two. And it's actually about to leave Europe, and I don't think it's coming back for quite some time. This might be our only chance. Do you want to head down to Southampton and have a look at it?
Probably not.
You're in America still. Anyway, it's traveling at 20 knots. I just love saying knots. So,
what's a knot, though? I never know. How fast is a knot?
It's about a mile per hour.
Why don't they say miles per hour, then, if it's about a mile per hour?
I don't know, because of tying knots in ropes and sailing and stuff. But I just think it's cool to say knots.
Mm-hmm.
So, for once, Anthem of the Seas is actually sailing and not sitting in a port. Mm-hmm. But our second mascot ship, our second flagship, Majesty of the Seas, is docked at Key West. So for those of you who are following the progress of our mascot ships, there you go.
Following the non-live progress of the ships. Because by the time they hear this podcast, those ships are somewhere else. They have since left Southampton, and you will have had dinner with the captain or whatever you're going to do when you go down and meet them.
Imagine that if I had dinner with the captain of the Anthem of the Seas.
Yeah?
That'd be pretty special. We could talk about knots. And if you were having dinner with a ship captain, what sort of things would you want to ask?
Well, I'd really want the ship captain to take me down to the engine room.
Oh, yeah.
That's the thing that I would want
to see. I'm totally on board with you there. Straight to the engine room. I'd be like, stuff this, mate. Let's eat on the move. I want to pull the horn.
Yes.
I want to see the engine room. I want to talk about huge propellers. And I want to see your maps.
I expect to hear all about the engine room after you have dinner with the Captain Brady.
Well, hey, I don't know. He might not take me down. He might have lots of questions he wants to ask me about videos and podcasts, and we might reach an impasse there. I'll be like, show me your propellers. And he'll be like, not till you tell me about what software you edit on.
That's going to be the conversation. Tell me about your bandwidth problems uploading to YouTube. How long does it take to process the videos? I'm so excited.
I'll only show you the engine room if you tell me what CGP Grey really looks like. Let's move on from ships, because if we talk about them for any longer, I'm just going to give you too much of an excuse to cut this section of the podcast.
Oh, it's already going to be short, buddy.
I can already feel your finger hovering over the cut button. In fact, you've probably stopped recording at the moment.
Yeah, I'm taking a little break.
Thank you for indulging me.
Shall I indulge you even further by introducing the next topic, which is Freebooting Takes the World by Storm Corner?
There comes a time in life when your children leave home. You're no longer responsible for them. You no longer have to give them money, but also they no longer have to obey your commands.
Uh-huh.
This is a natural part of life. And so it is with the word freebooting. I think freebooting has come of age in the last few weeks. Mm-hmm. And you and I, as co-founders of the word, apparently, Hello Internet, as the parents of this word, this new mm-hmm. use of the word for the mm-hmm. illegal taking and re-uploading and hosting of online content, particularly videos, mm-hmm. we have to let it go. It's gotten bigger than us, and it has left the nest and gone out into the world to blaze its own path. And while I will forever be proud of it mm-hmm. and our little role in its creation, it's moved on.
It has moved on. There have been a few articles, and I think the reason why you are describing it this way, in that the word has moved on, is that we have, for the first time, seen people use the word freebooting without making any reference to Brady Haran and CPG Grey as the creators of this word.
Yeah. Which is fine, but in addition to that, it has sort of also gone into some bigger arenas now. I mean, we saw Hank Green use it in his excellent article that he recently wrote about freebooting. Mm-hmm. We've seen it on the BBC website. We've seen it in places like Slate. Mm-hmm. And it's just being used as the normal word now. And the days of us getting excited and going, oh, look, that's a little victory for us, they're over. Mm-hmm. But also, I think it's really important to really quickly point out that while we'll always joke around about the word and its humble origins here on Hello Internet, freebooting itself is a very serious issue. Do you not agree?
No, yes, it is.
Well, why are you laughing?
I'm agreeing.
You're laughing.
I'm laughing because of your tone of voice, Brady.
It was a bit after school special, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah, I know.
It's like, we've all had fun this afternoon, but drug addiction is a serious problem. And you're like, is it? Because the way you're saying it, even though it is a serious problem, certainly doesn't sound like it is.
There was a funny story in a picture that came from Destin in Alabama, I think a week or two ago. He's obviously been a real campaigner on this issue, and he has also been one of the real trailblazers using the term freebooting. And mm-hmm. his local TV station in Alabama, I think, I haven't actually spoken to him about this, but this is what I've sort of sketched together from various text messages we've shared. I think mm-hmm. his local TV station decided to do a story about freebooting and Facebook freebooting. And I guess they were taking the parochial angle of, you know, local guy makes good and leads the charge sort of thing, you know, local Alabama man and YouTube star campaigns against the mighty Facebook. So I think mm-hmm. they did an interview with him and spoke to him about it. I haven't actually seen the report yet. But what happened was they then said to him, oh, Destin, can we please use some of the footage from your freebooting video to kind of illustrate our report, you know, examples of the stuff that was freebooted and presumably footage of Destin, which makes perfectly sense because, you know, they want to couch him in the terms of being this YouTuber and show an example of it. So, of course, Destin said, yes, you know, okay, in that go ahead, you can use my footage. So do you know what they did? They went into Destin's video about freebooting, and the one clip they took out to use was the clip that he borrowed from me of Audrey playing with bubbles. And they put that into their report and had it like marked youtube.com/smarterevery day. And there's Audrey chasing bubbles around.
Perfect.
So I got freebooted. Destin, of course, did have permission to use that bubbles footage, but I don't know about Alabama television stations.
I don't think permission is a transitive property.
No. Destin thought it was hilarious. Sent me a photo from the report saying, have a look at this.
It is pretty funny. But you touched upon the reason why I think this word has now come into its own is that while, you know, it has left our house of Hello Internet and it has gone in many ways to the house of Facebook to cause a lot of problems, because that's where I see it always being used in context, is talking about the changes that are happening at Facebook, as Facebook is clearly making some moves into the video world. But that's where the word is always being used, about how Facebook is making money off of other people's content and not sharing back the revenue. Yeah. And intentionally dragging their feet. And so this is where I have seen it being used, is describing this as Facebook freebooting almost all the time. And that was partly the topic of Hank's article. Yes. Talking about how Facebook is doing things like inflating the numbers of views on their videos by huge orders of magnitude. If a video appears anywhere on someone's Facebook feed, even if they don't look at it itself, like Facebook counts that as a view.
Yeah, they sneakily start it playing before you have time to react.
Yeah, they start it. They start it playing immediately, and they're like, "Oh, you watch this for a tenth of a second before you hit pause. That totally counts as a view." Yeah. And that's part of the reason why the view numbers on Facebook are just astronomical. You see numbers just in the tens of millions or billions or trillions. You know, like there's not enough humans on Earth to have caused all these views. Facebook's like, "Oh no, it totally counts." All of Facebook's little tricks are kind of a little story right now, and that's where we also see the word freebooting come into play, because it's a nice alliteration.
It is. Facebook freebooting is a nice alliteration, and I can't even take the credit for that. I think Destin started that with his videos. I will do a quick little serious thing then before we continue with our various bits of follow-up, because seeing we're talking about freebooting, because I have had a little interesting interaction over the last couple of days, so I thought I'd tell, well, I'll tell you about it. I haven't told you about it yet.
Mm-hmm.
And those people listening to Halo Internet can eavesdrop, because that's pretty much how this works.
Yep.
Now, there is a, this all relates to a Twitter account, a Twitter feed. At this stage, I'm not going to say what it is, partly because I don't want to give them free publicity, partly right. because also I don't want to sort of be, you know, lynch mob or judge and jury over an individual. You know, you know how I feel about that. So I don't want to be too guilty of it myself.
After the last episode where you say you don't like lynch mobs, it would not seem great if you were at the head of a lynch mob today.
Exactly. But there is this Twitter account which I came across this week. I actually just sent the Twitter handle to you not 20 minutes ago.
Mm-hmm.
How would you explain this Twitter account to people?
I'm just scrolling through and looking at it right now. And this is an account that tweets GIFs. And they're tweeting GIFs mainly from science or science-y related videos.
Yeah.
And as I'm scrolling through... I mean, it's just an endless list of stuff they didn't make, much of which is actually watermarked with the real creators.
Sometimes, yeah.
One of the videos I'm looking at right now is a GIF, and it is clearly cropped very awkwardly. So this is one that someone decided they could take out the watermark.
Yeah.
But it is basically a freebooting type of account, because they're taking the best parts from various science videos from various creators and tweeting it without any link back to the author, even at a bare minimum.
And even if they were doing that, I wouldn't condone it, but they're certainly not doing that either.
People on the internet always go, isn't it okay if someone just credits you? And the answer is no. Like, it's
no.
Credit doesn't make it okay, but they're not even doing that, that the barest of bare minimums of saying, oh, this comes from a video with whatever. They're just saying, look at this cool explosion. Look at this cool science experiment.
Yeah.
And all the GIFs are, again, like the prime 5 seconds of a whole lot of science videos.
Exactly. I think this is like the online video equivalent of one of those rooms they have at a police station, just full of stolen property.
Infringed property.
Full of infringed property. It's a freebooting fiesta.
Yes.
And there are lots of Twitter accounts like this. You know, this is a problem. And we talk about freebooting being a big problem on Facebook, and it is. And I think you know, that's the most important place at the moment. And it seems to be where the battle line is drawn. But I think this sort of GIF freebooting is also a really big issue. And perhaps once Facebook sort their house out, this is the next place where this battle needs to be fought.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I was going through this Twitter feed, and there were, and there still are, lots of clips from my videos in there. Now, I am far from the only victim. As we speak now, you will see Derek numerous times and other videos from people I know. I saw one there by the physics girl, and I'm sure Destin must be on there as well, because his videos are so good for that sort of thing.
Mm.
This is one of the parts of freebooting where I feel like you're a bit luckier, because a CGP Grey video doesn't really make sense if you haven't got the whole video. You don't normally have a golden bullet that can be stolen from your video. But
I do have the problem where someone takes all of the slides from my video and writes an article with a little caption below each of them.
It becomes like a PowerPoint almost.
It'll turn into one of those crap slideshows where they try to get 20 clicks out of you.
Okay.
I can understand why it happens, but the GIF freebooting is huge.
Yeah.
Where I see it, for example, is on Reddit.
Yes.
And I cannot believe the number of times when a GIF of a video makes it to the front page, where even linking to the video would be a vastly more enjoyable experience than linking to the GIF. I find it very surprising, but there's something about GIFs and their loopingness that seems to really, really catch people's minds and encourage spreadability. even in situations where a GIF seems like the worst possible way to show whatever it is you want to show. I find it very, very surprising how fast and how far just the worst GIFs can spread.
Yeah. So I went to a couple of the GIFs here on this account that were from my videos. Mm-hmm. And I kind of was just lying in bed. So I actually decided I'd have a look at what the process is for making a copyright report on Twitter, because I'd never done it before.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've never had to do it either. Interesting.
Yeah. So anyway, I went through the process. It wasn't too bad. It was like all these copyright processes. They put quite a few hurdles in your way and they make you work for it. But, right. But I did it. For two of these GIFs that I'd found, I reported them. They'd been on the Twitter feed for quite a while. They'd been retweeted and favorited in the thousands of times.
Mm-hmm.
So they had gone everywhere. You know, their day was done. But I reported them just out of, I don't know, partly because I wanted to see the process. And reasonably quickly, I got an email back from Twitter saying, "We've removed them. There you go." I then scrolled down the Twitter feed and found a bunch more of mine. I thought, oh gosh, how many of these do I have to do? But before I got to any of that, I received an email from the person who runs the Twitter account. "Hey Brady, I saw you filed a copyright claim for one of my GIF images I've shared. I've removed both of the pictures." Well, actually, I think Twitter removed them, but maybe he removed them first. I don't know. And then he said, "Do you think it's possible to remove the copyright claim from my account?"
Yeah, said, I've had this thing on YouTube.
And
yeah.
Then he helpfully said, "And is there more content you want removed? I will gladly do so." So I didn't reply to that because, like you said, we get that kind of thing a bit. So
yeah, let me interject something here, which is just so the listener understands. The reason it sounds like Twitter has a similar-ish system to YouTube, and the reason he wants you to remove your copyright complaint is, at least the way it works on YouTube, is that if a YouTube channel has, I think it's 3 simultaneous outstanding copyright complaints against it, that channel, the whole thing will just get taken down. So there's a cumulative punishment for repeatedly infringing copyright on YouTube, which is a channel ban if it happens enough. But if you convince the person who filed the claim against you to remove it, you just basically have another free shot at infringement. Every single time I ever file a copyright complaint against anybody, I hear back from them saying, "Oh, we took it down and please remove the complaint," which, as far as I'm concerned, is just a request. Like, please allow us to continue infringing copyright in the future. Like, that's the only way to interpret that message.
But then I got an even longer email. "Brady Harron, I am the owner of twitter.com/ the name of this account, which is a page mm-hmm. I've built as a hobby from finding and sharing science-related GIF images from all over the internet. I do not profit from the tweets. I simply do it for fun." Let me stop there. Can I just say that this Twitter account has approaching 900,000 followers. And if you think building a following of 900,000 people on Twitter is not a form of profit you have made with this material, which I think a lot of you shouldn't have. I beg to differ on that whole profit thing. But, and then the final sentence is, "Would you mind taking down the notice?" So do they mm-hmm. want me to withdraw my thing? "And also," I thought this was unbelievably cheeky, "and also, would you send the clips you would like me to upload?" Anyway, I did reply at this point. I believe I was polite mm-hmm. and respectful and I wished them success, but I also made my position clear about what I thought was not right about what they were doing. Mm-hmm. I got another really long reply. I won't read it all, but I'll try and find a couple of highlights here. "Brady, I'm sorry you feel this way. I've been going through all the content trying to remove anything that seems to affect your YouTube channel."
Mm-hmm.
"I thought it was more of a free promotion, as if someone wanted to watch the full clip, they would search online and find your video." I'll stop here again for just a second. That's a crazy claim, because mm-hmm. there's virtually no identification of what the clip is or where it's from, and you'd have to have very good Google foo to go from these animated GIFs to find my video. But that's by the by. People don't do that anyway. Once they've seen the money shot, why would they do that anyway? "I never upload the actual video, only ever a 4 to 5 second GIF and no sound, and I mostly find my content from Reddit or 9gag, which is why I was unaware." So they're saying, "I didn't even know where it came from. I just took it from somewhere else."
Right. "Other people will watch this video, but I don't even know where it's from."
"Nah. Science GIFs are very popular on Reddit, and usually if you look at the tweets, someone posts the video, so it does do traffic to your videos. Also, I thought I was within fair use policy, as I'm sharing for knowledge purposes only. I also state in the Twitter bio that I do not own the content.
Copyright not intended.
And I think this belies their true knowledge. And also, this is also in their Twitter bio. And there is there is a removal request. I have my email in the bio, and I always remove. So, I mean, he's basically saying, I've put the email there because I'm always getting complaints and told to remove stuff. Mm-hmm. He says, hopefully we can resolve this. I'd be happy to work with you in the future. I feel like someone has come into my house and taken a whole bunch of my things, like my TV and my sofa and mm-hmm. my computer. I know you think it's different because... But let's just tell what I feel like. I feel like I've taken my TV and my sofa and my computer and my fridge and all these things. And so I have suffered, even unknowingly in this case, but I've suffered for a little while. And then I have found out where my TV and sofa is. And I've said, oi, I want it back. And this person has said, look, here's your TV and your sofa. And I know you've kind of done without and I've benefited from having it for the last few weeks, but I've given it back. Can you not press charges? Because I don't want the police onto me, because if the police are onto me, I won't be able to go and steal everyone else's TV and sofa. So can you not press charges so the police won't prosecute me? Oh, and by the way, I've still got your computer in your fridge.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want them back, I'll give them to you, but don't stop me from taking other people's stuff. It's crazy. I'm displeased.
Your analogy is terribly tangled, but we will draw from it the value that is within it. Because in this analogy, if we were continuing it further, other people would be coming to his house and watching stuff on your TV, and he would be asking if it's okay for him to continue using the TV as long as he tells everybody that it's your TV. Would that work well in this analogy
nice,
for you?
Nice, great.
Does that make sense?
Or you're improving the analogy. Good work.
Or is this falling down into a mess of unutility?
No, I like it.
That's a different... No.
You've enhanced it. enhanced it.
It's absolutely terrible. The one point that jumps out to me on this, which is conversation that I see happen over and over again on Reddit, and I stay out of it because it's frustrating, but I just want to put on the record here, is someone will link to, say, a freebooted material, or they'll link to a GIF, or they'll link to some subsection of someone's content. And because Reddit is usually pretty good about someone knows where this thing is from, the top comment will almost always be, oh, the source is this thing, right? So if you click on the discussion, you'll see right away at the top, here's where it comes from. Now, as someone who has had many things on Reddit, I've even gotten things on the front page of Reddit, and has also been someone who's had infringe stuff get very high on Reddit, and then I see the top comment says, oh, the source of this is originally CGP Grey. I actually have a bunch of data about what the difference is between those two things. And everybody seems to think that, oh, the source comment makes it all okay. But it can be a difference of two orders of magnitude how many people click on the link on Reddit to go to the infringe thing versus how many people click on that comment that says, oh, the original source is from here. Yeah. So, like, it is by no means making up for it or making it okay. And I just see people say, like, oh, isn't it free promotion? Aren't you happy to get this promotion? And I always feel like if the people making the things don't want this kind of promotion, it should be pretty clear to everybody in the discussion that no, it's not the kind of promotion that people want, or it is not as helpful as people think it is. But I just see this argument over and over again where people say, oh, anybody using your material is just great promotion. Yeah. And I even get tweets sometimes where people say, oh, I saw your video on some news channel in some foreign country. You know, isn't that great promotion for you?
Yeah.
And it's always like, it's news to me that it's there. Yeah. And no, it's not any kind of great promotion almost always. And I would never agree to it if they asked me ahead of time, which is precisely why they don't. So it's just... further discussions in the frustrations of online creators.
When this exchange first started, it did cross my mind that maybe I was going to be dealing with like a kid or a teenager, because, you know, kids and teenagers can get lucky and have awesomely followed Twitter accounts as well. And so, there were points during this exchange where I was so stunned by the naivety being displayed that I thought maybe it was a child. I mean, reading back, I think it is an adult, and there are a few things that tell me that I am dealing with an adult. But the naivety and the lack of understanding of what's going on here is stunning to me. And for someone like that to then have wield the power of 900,000 Twitter followers is we live in worrying times.
You know, some of the guidelines about what counts as copyright infringement, and people always say, though, I didn't make any money off of it. But one of the key factors is, does the use of the material impact the market for the original thing?
Yeah.
And without a doubt, these GIFs just totally decimate the market for the original thing. There's nobody who follows through and wants to watch the rest of it because they've already seen the heart of it. Like, that's not what fair use is. Yeah. But everybody seems to take fair use as, oh, I'm not making any money and I like sharing this, so isn't that fair?
And
it's not fair.
And the other thing I find a little bit frustrating is there seems to be this mindset towards educational material that it's different and that it's sort of altruistic, and because it's sharing knowledge, and sharing knowledge is like a good thing, and it's not just trying to sell cans of Coca-Cola, that everything could be shared, and it's all one big group hug. And if I'm sharing knowledge and talking about knowledge and facts and information, or I'm helping educate people and I'm using your awesome footage to do it, that's okay because education is good.
Mm-hmm.
And education is good. But I tell you what, you go and start a Twitter account where you just show GIFs of every home run hit in Major League Baseball each day, and you see how long that account lasts.
I've spoken to some people who work in the world of writing educational books, and the things that publishers will say to them is just shocking, where it's like, oh, do you want to get paid what a normal author would get paid for your education book? Don't you just want to write a book that's read by a lot of people? And we don't really need to pay you for that, right? Because you just love sharing knowledge, and we'll just keep all that. It's like the money, there's still money somewhere. It hasn't just disappeared.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's this weird in the whole industry of media production, this kind of this presumption of discount towards anything that is vaguely educational. It's kind of understandable, that feeling, but it's still very frustrating if you are the producer of educational material that also lots of people want to watch, that's popular.
Well, let's take money out of the equation for a second. Let's pretend we live in a world where money doesn't matter and we have a different currency. And say the currency was Twitter followers or YouTube subscribers or just, you know, fan base, because in many ways that is our currency. This person and people like it are stealing that. They're building their following based on my content, and people may not even know this stuff came from me, and they could have been people that started following me instead. So even if they haven't stolen dollars from my wallet, they've stolen another form of currency. So
I often think that the real currency that we deal with on the internet is human time and attention.
Hmm.
And that sometimes that converts at a rate into dollars. But when you're on the internet, that is really the currency exchange that is happening between various parties, is how is human time and attention spent in various ways. And I do think those are two slightly different things. You know, how much time do you spend on something, and how much attention do you pay to something? That's like the bottom level of the economy, really. And then other things are built on top of that, but particularly on the internet. Or yes, a science Twitter account that's taking other people's stuff. You can measure the amount of human time and attention that they have acquired for themselves.
Do you have any other thoughts hearing any of that exchange? Were you struck by anything? This interaction with a real life freebooter?
I mean, not really. It sounds so very similar to the same things that I get for myself every time you try to track someone down, which is why I don't really think that it was, as you were saying before, naivete. I just think it's a situation where if I'm hearing the same thing from everybody every time there's anything going on about infringement, it's like, I think they know, and they're just running down the list of plausible deniability reasons, trying to delay or tire you out in the interaction so you just give up.
Yeah, maybe I'm not. Maybe I thought this person was stupid. Maybe I'm not giving them enough credit. All right, there we go. Enough of that. This episode has been sponsored by Fracture. Now, this is a great service. You get your pictures literally printed onto pieces of glass for display in your home or your office, wherever else you want to, well, look at pictures. All sorts of sizes are available, and I really recommend their website for some nice shots and video about how it all works. They obviously explain it way better than I will. Now, we've been talking long enough about these guys that some of you have cottoned on to how cool they are getting your own pictures fractured. And as is the way of the world, some of you have been emailing us the results. I was particularly impressed by one from Jake, who had some really nice family shots done. They caught my eye because Jake was wearing a Liverpool Football Club shirt that always earns an enthusiastic reply. But they looked really good. You also might remember Derek, the skydiver, from a previous podcast. That's Derek, not Dirk Derek. Well, he takes awesome freefall photos, and he told me that he's now sent off to have one of them fractured and, I guess, put up on the wall or something like that. I told him when he does what he should do is take the fractured picture up on a skydive with it and sort of hold it up as he falls and then get that picture fractured. So then he'll have like a fracture of a fracture, some sort of photographic inception going on here. Now, if you've got pictures gathering virtual dust in your computer archives, why not get them out and have them on show? And this really is a brilliant way to do it. The website is fractureme.com. That's obviously where you can get them, but also learn all about how it works. It's really brilliant. And here's the important bit. The code HELLOINTERNET, all one word, will get you 15% off your first order. 15%, that's the word HELLOINTERNET. Use that code. fractureme.com. And our thanks to Fracture for supporting the podcast. Don't forget to send me your pictures when they're done. I've got something I'm really looking forward to, Gray. Things and jobs that people do while listening to the Hello Internet Podcast Corner.
Oh, you have more emails.
Oh, I've got loads, but I haven't got loads for you now. I'm just going to do a couple of quickies.
First of all, my most important question is, are they printed on paper right now? Oh, I think that the paper is a fundamental part of stuff people do while listening to the Podcast Corner. I really like the paper.
All right. You've got paper.
I wanted to set the mood before we talk about people's careers or other things they do, not just careers.
I saw a really funny comment either on Twitter or Reddit. I can't remember where and I can't remember who wrote it. So I'm sorry for not giving you a name check. But they were talking about last time's things people do while listening to Hello Internet Podcast Corner. Mm-hmm. You know how I like built it up and said, this is amazing. And you said, and you were worried it wasn't going to be amazing. Mm-hmm. They said, as they were listening, they sort of thought to themselves or said out loud, if this job doesn't end up involving Barack Obama, I'm going to be disappointed. And sure enough, we delivered. Anyway, we haven't got anything quite so presidential this time, but I've got two quickies that I like. I've received mm-hmm. many. I am keeping quite a few of them, and we'll do more and we'll talk about it more later, but we'll just do a couple of quickies now. This one comes from Emily. And it says, Dear Brady and Gray, I was listening to the most recent episodes at work today, and it occurred to me that you, especially Brady, might be interested in what I do. I'm a member of the operations team on the Cassini mission.
Cool.
I don't control the spacecraft directly, but I thought you'd both enjoy knowing that sometimes, somewhere in the world, there is someone listening to your podcasts while she designs observations for a camera orbiting Saturn. Love the show, Emily. I mean, Cassini is...
That's pretty good.
That's the glamour mission for me as well. I mean, that's like, that's the pretty boy space mission, isn't it? With all those great photos of Saturn. You can't go wrong.
That's a pretty good one.
Not bad.
I mean, all the space missions are cool.
Yeah.
But pictures of Saturn, you know, is unusually photogenic for a planet.
Yeah. So there's Emily, obviously designing observations. I'd like to know more about what that means. Presumably she programs what way it's going to point and when to take all the pictures, but you can certainly email me again, Emily. You cannot email me too many times about what you do on the Cassini mission. I'd love to hear more, but that's a good one.
Yeah, that is a very good one.
And I'll just do one more. This one comes from someone who sounds very Australian. It comes from Dave. Mm-hmm. Dave says, G'day, fellas. First off, I'd like to tell Bradley, that I'm a fellow Adelaidean, but had to move for employment. However, as a kid, I did not find the Grenfell Centre the awe-inspiring piece of architectural grandeur that he did. I also have never heard anyone but him call it the Black Stump. That makes me think Dave might be younger than me, because it was only really famous before when it was the tallest building, and when it was no longer the tallest building, it kind of fell into obscurity, but maybe, who knows? Anyway, let's hear about Dave's job, because that's where things get really interesting.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, but you always have to mention those Adelaide things.
Oh, yeah.
You love the Adelaide.
Big time, big time.
Adelaide's like the secret keyword to getting through your email system.
You just saying that has reminded me of several other Adelaide emails I've received this week that I could talk about, but I won't.
Do you see? It's like it's a tight little cluster of Adelaide excitement in your brain.
Although my job may not seem the most exciting, well, think again, Dave, but here we go. I absolutely love it. I drive a fuel truck called an AB quad in the outback, Western Australia. Western Australia is the biggest state of Australia. It's massive. My truck, fully loaded, can hold roughly 135,000 litres of fuel, diesel mainly, and a bit of petrol for servos in remote areas. Servos is what Australians call service stations or garages. Hmm. This AB quad truck that Dave drives is 53.5 metres long. It weighs around 165 tonnes loaded and has 86 tyres. The run I do is about 1,500 kilometres round trip from depot to the mine site towns. Obviously, there's a lot of mines in Western Australia, and he's obviously delivering all this diesel fuel to all the mines. Anyway, enough about the truck. I cannot tell you how disappointed I was to read those words, because I could have heard about that truck forever. But anyway.
Yeah, my feeling is the same. Wait, but more about the truck.
No, no. We'll come back to the truck in a second.
All I'm thinking of listening to this is, this sounds like a truck to have in a Mad Max-style apocalyptic future.
I know.
Like, this guy's prepared.
In Outback Australia, we're better for a Mad Max truck. Anyway, enough about the truck. I listen to your podcast on the 12-hour shifts I drive on the track. It was a good laugh hearing that people fall asleep during the podcast. If I were to fall asleep on the job, entire towns could be blown off the map. Unfortunately, I don't have a photo, brackets, apparently because of terrorists, all recording of our trucks is banned, end brackets. However, the one attached is near enough to what I drive, and he attaches a picture of this sort of semi-trailer with one, two...
Let me see.
Four or five fuel tanks towing behind it. And I'm going to send it to you now in between Audrey waking up and licking my hand. Hang on.
Yeah.
Let me get it for you. I actually wasn't going to send it to you. I didn't think you'd be so into it. Hang on.
No, I want to see
it.
It's
coming. It's coming. Here it comes.
I want to see the gear, man. I want to see it.
It's coming. Big time. Here it is. Hang on.
All right, you go play with Audrey. I'm going to look at this truck.
Hang on. Oops, I'm sending that to Destin. He would like it, but he might get confused. Hang on.
He's going to love it.
I'd send it to Destin. He'd probably reply with something like, yep, drove one of them yesterday. Yep. there we go. You should have it.
Wow. If trucks could be snakes, that's what this looks like. Boy, that is really interesting.
In Australia, you call these things road trains. And I mean, you can see on the front there, it's got road train written on the front of it. But I've never seen one that long. I've seen one that are like two or three trailers, but obviously, they just need so much fuel at those mines that...
I have never seen anything like this. Just to describe it, it's... I mean, usually I've seen the truck and it has the single cylindrical container behind it that's on an additional four or five sets of wheels.
Yeah.
But this picture that he sent of a similar truck has four of them, it looks like, chained up behind it. I didn't even know you could do that.
No. That's a lot of fuel. Not a bad one there, that. So it's not quite the presidential stairs, but in some ways, it's as impressive.
This is very interesting to me. You know, this is, I like logistics.
Yeah.
I wonder if these things are even allowed in the US. I have never, like, I've driven a lot around the US on a lot of roads where there's a lot of cargo being transported, and I have never seen anything like this. So I wonder if it even exists in the US. Or if this is just a badass Australian thing.
I don't know. They're pretty hard as nails over there, so...
Yeah.
So I just did a Google search on AB quad, and it takes you to road train, and the top image is the one he sent, so that's obviously where he got it. but if you look at the Wikipedia article, you look at all the different rules and regulations and classes, and there's these K class ones, and it says these represent the largest road trains operating in Australia and the world, called a power train or a body and six. There's a whole bunch of stuff about them on Wikipedia, of course.
Wow. This is exciting. I never knew these things existed, and now I want to see one in real life. I want to see one of these K-trains with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 cargo slots behind them.
I'm not lying, Gray. I want to see one with the Hello Internet podcast on a phone in front of it. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah. Yeah. Any K-train drivers, if you're out there, if you have one of these trains, Hello Internet logo on your iPhone in front of this train, that would be appreciated. But I would really like to see one in real life as well at some point. Very exciting. I like this a lot. What's going on over there? What's that noise?
It's Audrey. She's gotten up.
How is Audrey making that much noise?
She's quite noisy for a little one. I'll pick her up. Hang on. You going to make any noise with the microphone? No? No.
Oh, now she goes silent.
She's silent because she's getting attention. She just makes a little snuffly noise. You got the picture?
So the dogs are sleeping at your feet.
All right, let's move on. I don't know what to do about Audrey, but I'm just going to leave her for a minute. If she starts getting too noisy, we'll take action. Fine. On your bed, little. Go on. Go and sit on Lulu. There you go. Go to sleep. No, don't lick Lulu.
Is Lulu her bed?
Pretty much. That's pretty much how it works. Mm-hmm. Okay, Gray. This is the moment we've all been waiting for. In the last podcast, we heard from a listener who has gustatory synesthesia.
Yes.
In this particular case, what happens is when they hear words, they taste them. Words have different tastes. And they sent a list of 10 words that they wanted to be said by you because they thought they would taste interesting. They particularly wanted to hear them. Mm-hmm. And there was one they wanted to hear from me as well. And obviously this person tapped into the little bit of competitive nature between us and knew how excited I was that there was a word that might sound better from me. Mm-hmm. So they have been in touch since you and I read this list of words, and they tell us what each of those words tastes like, and they tell us which one of us says it in a more tasty way. Mm-hmm. Are you ready for this?
Okay, let's go.
Because.
All right, because.
Now, because tastes like Frank and beans.
Hmm.
And it tastes better when I say it. Welcome.
Welcome.
Now, welcome tastes like something that I don't actually know what this is, but maybe you do. A graham cracker?
Oh, a graham cracker.
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
It's a... I was about to say, in the most unhelpful way, it tastes graham crackery. But that doesn't... I don't know how... I feel like, a graham cracker is a thing you give kids, in kindergarten to munch on.
Are they sweet or savory?
Slightly sweet. They're like a soft, I don't know what to compare them to.
It's soft, but why is it called a cracker if I thought crackers were hard?
Well, so here's the thing. They're soft because when you're a little kid, you gum on them, right? And they sort of become soft in your mouth. I don't know how to describe them. They're cookie-like is the best description, maybe.
Well, it tastes better when you say it, but only just. Apparently, it was very close run. Next word, before.
Before.
That is Ritz peanut butter crackers. And that is a tie between the two of us. The next word is like.
Like.
That tastes like cottage cheese, and it tastes unusually strong when Gray says it. Unusually strong.
Hmm.
Your like is very cottage cheesy, Gray. next we have integral.
Uh-huh. Integral.
Macaroni and cheese.
Oh, that's nice.
Gray sort of stumbled while saying it, so there was no taste when he said it. But to be honest, the way you, as in Brady, said it, tasted worse than average. But I have a very high standard for this one because of the way my calculus teacher said it, which tasted very good. Possibility.
Possibility.
This is fusilli pasta or pasta with red sauce and grated cheese. Yeah?
Hmm. That's a complicated one.
Yeah. And the listener says, this one is kind of weird. Though to be fair, all of this is weird, but the red sauce to cheese ratio was a lot higher when Gray said it.
I have to say, listening to all of this, I am very glad that I do not have gustatory synesthesia.
Waiting.
Waiting.
Tomato soup, and it tastes better when Gray says it. Next word, family.
Family.
Banana, and it tastes better when Gray says it.
I wonder if banana tastes like banana.
I don't know. That's a good question, actually.
Like, when you say the food, does it taste like the food?
Oh, yeah, I wonder if there are like special words that are like palindromes and things that taste like themselves. That's a good question. I didn't ask that. Mm-hmm. Passion.
Passion.
Some sort of barely carbonated fruit juice substance that I've never quite been able to place, but I think there is melon involved. And apparently both of us pronounce it in a way that tastes better than average. Now, the last word, which is the one that he thought would taste better from me, was party.
Party.
Okay. That tastes like chocolate cake.
Seems appropriate.
And as I suspected, it tastes significantly better when Brady said it.
Your accent makes words with the T and R sound better.
Because when you say party, it sounds like the T becomes a D, like you're saying party, not party.
Yeah, that's partly my growing up in New York sliding through there is the T to D transition.
Yeah.
I have a very hard time with words like that. Words like water. As I cannot say that word normally with a T sound, there's a D sound when I say water.
You can tell, Gray, that the word naughty is completely tasteless. For me, the vast majority of words don't have a taste, and naughty happens to be one that doesn't. So I replied with a few little follow-up requests. So I've got a little bit of extra information for you here. I asked whether our names tasted like anything, and apparently they don't. The only two names of people that do have tastes, apparently, are Emily, which tastes like banana, and Rachel, which tastes like cherry. And I did confirm that both Derek and Dirk do not have tastes. And also, I can confirm that freebooting does not have a taste. And that's about it for now for what words taste like quarter.
This is getting too specific now, Brady.
All right. There you go.
I heard you had an interesting meetup recently
with someone. I did. And this is one to thank the Hello Internet listeners for in many ways. So I'm sure people remember, but you and I both spoke about the album The Race for Space by Public Service Broadcasting, which I love.
Yes.
And you spoke quite highly of as well.
I thought it was good. It was not for me personally. Yeah. But actually, I have listened to it a couple more times since then. I feel like it might be growing on me slightly, but I would still recommend that everybody give it a listen.
Brilliant album, brilliant album. And for those who don't remember, it's these musicians, this band that combine just cool modern music that I happen to like anyway with audio samples and historic audio samples from old propaganda films and newsreels and archive and things like that. So The Race for Space deals with Sputnik and Yuri Gagarin and the Apollo missions, using all the old broadcasts from the time and all the old NASA radio transmissions. And they do it in a really clever way, really clever way.
It's the Brady album. It couldn't be more for Brady.
It couldn't be more for me. And one of the songs they did before this on one of their other albums is about Mount Everest. So I was joking that these are like my dream people. So I was bigging it up in the flattering way that these things happen. A lot of the listeners gave it a try based on our recommendation. And a lot of people said they really liked it. And a lot of them said so on Twitter and on social media, saying thanks for the recommendation. And they kind of called it out and shouted it out to the band as well. They're a London-based band. So as a result, suddenly I think these guys were seeing kind of their Twitter feed full of a lot of talk about Hello Internet and at Brady Heron and at CGP Grey. And so suddenly they sort of became aware, I think, that at least that we existed. So basically, as a result, a little bit of Twitter conversation ensued, and they actually performed at the Glastonbury Music Festival that I went to, and I had actually arranged to try and meet up with them, and they joked they were going to buy me a cider for helping them sell some more albums. But I ended up leaving Glastonbury early, and one of the guys in the band wasn't well, so that never happened. So I thought, oh, that's an opportunity missed. But we have stayed in touch, and amazingly, the creative force behind the band, kind of the main man, whose stage name is J. Wilgoose Esquire. He's an interesting character.
That's not his real name? That's a stage name?
Apparently so. Anyway, I don't know how. I think I must have used Jedi mind tricks. But I persuaded him yesterday to come along to the Royal Society and appear as a special guest in my objectivity videos.
You bring everybody to the Royal Society.
I know. I think that was obviously the bait. So he came along, and I'd actually arranged with Keith, the head librarian there, we'd arranged a series of really amazing space artifacts to do with Sputnik and Gagarin and Apollo. We got some real amazing things that I was drooling all over. And we took Jay down to see them and spoke to him, and he appeared in the video and another video. And then And then we went out afterwards and he bought me my ciders and we hung out for a while and had a really good time, got along really well. And it wouldn't have been possible if it wasn't for Hello Internet and then the ensuing good comments from Hello Internet listeners. The main moral of the story here is if you ever do anything because of Hello Internet that you think could have any positive, anything positive coming from it, make sure you go on Twitter and tell the people because it really helps us do our job. Because I can't imagine I would have ever got to have met Jay or did what we did if it wasn't for people on Twitter. And it seems like a little... It actually really helps. So thank you, everyone. And hopefully in the week that this podcast goes out, that video might be out as well and people can have a look. But it was really cool.
Were you able to convince him to do that adorable Chihuahua-based album we were discussing last time?
No, we didn't get onto the topic of Chihuahua-based albums. I feel like I missed opportunity. He's a lot like you in a lot of ways, Gray. There are a lot of things about Jay that reminded me of you. I think you two would get along really well as well. And one of them is his secrecy about upcoming projects, which I mm-hmm. guess is even more important when you make albums. So he was tight-lipped.
He sounds like a smart man.
He is a very smart man. He was tight-lipped about the topic of the next album, and rightly so. Mm. But it was good. It was really good. It was good fun.
I was wondering if you had fangirled in the meeting.
I think I played it pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, you didn't squeal?
No, I mean, I definitely like have a lot of respect for what these guys have created. I think it's a really great thing. And I do have a disproportionate amount of respect for people who can create music. Like even my mm-hmm. friend Alan, who makes music for my videos and who wrote the Hello Internet little jingle at the start of the show. Mm-hmm. I'm amazed by people who can do what they do. So I've got loads of respect. But I don't know, because of my job over the years, I kind of get exposed to lots of people who are like famous. So I don't get particularly starstruck. And it did help that when we were walking down the street together in London, someone came up to us and recognized me and not him. So
yeah, did you feel like that gave you an advantage in the celebrity meetup?
The dynamic wasn't really like that anyway, but it was funny. So uh-huh. But yeah, it was really good. It was really good. So I hope the videos turn out well. And seriously, like, I can't recommend the album enough. The mm-hmm. music video for Go, which I think is really good, was made by a company in Bristol, I think, for the mm-hmm. song called Go, which is the Apollo 11 song. It's got like something like 300,000 views. I think that's criminal. I think that is criminal that, you know, Taylor Swift will have 100 million views on a video. And yeah, I like Taylor Swift and her songs, but that will have like 100 million and this can have 300,000. There's something wrong with the world.
There's probably a GIF of it somewhere. It has 20 million views, a soundless looping GIF.
It was interesting how much we had to talk about in common about things like, oh, how do you use Twitter and how do you feel about copyright infringement and things mm-hmm. like that. Like a lot of the things we had to discuss were surprisingly similar. So, mm-hmm. except I'm really crap at music and he made a really cool album.
Yeah. The ability to make music seems like magic to me.
Yeah.
It's just like, how do you do that? It's, I find it impressive as well when anybody has any kind of musical skill.
I was talking to him about the Random Acts of Intelligence show, and I said, if they don't put on one of their shows at that Rocket Center in Huntsville, there's something wrong with the world. Can you imagine seeing them do their Apollo set under the Saturn V with all those Apollo spaceships everywhere?
That would be pretty cool.
It would be cool.
The best setting for any show in the world and the best setting if you are space themed.
Yeah. What's next?
Sorry, I was just freaking out because I was trying to be a reporter and come up with some questions to ask you.
You didn't do well, Gray.
No, I know I didn't. I'm very sorry, Brady.
YouTube will never get you to be one of those people who interviews the President of the United States.
Yeah, I would never interview the President of the United States. But yeah, I was just trying to think of something to ask you, and it was just silence in my brain.
I assumed there was something going wrong in the office or your computer was breaking. That's how awkward and quiet you sounded. Was that just you trying to think of a question to ask?
Honest to God, Brady. I was trying to think of questions to ask you because you told me that I needed to be a little bit of a reporter if we do this segment. And I don't know what to ask. What do I ask? This is where I have told you many times that you have this natural interviewing skill that you seem to just disregard because it comes so naturally to you.
Let me ask, let's do it this way, Gray, all right?
Yeah.
I think I sent you a message saying, oh, I just met with the guy from Public Service Broadcasting.
Right.
What do you want to know? What's the first thing you think? What's the first question that comes into your head? Not what do you think you should ask. What do you want to ask? Because that's probably a good start. What's the first question you have?
Yeah, the first thing I asked you was how the two of you met up. And
okay.
That's what you told us.
Okay, I told you that, yeah, because Twitter, because he had seen all these tweets mentioning us, so he kind of, we got force-fed to him, basically. And then I'd exchanged a few emails at Glastonbury. So we dealt with that. So now you know that.
Right. And then in iMessage, I also asked you if you fangirled big time when you met the person.
Yeah.
And so we did that.
Yeah.
Right. And then I feel like I don't know what to ask next.
Okay. Okay. You don't want, there's nothing else you want to know.
I guess the thing is, I feel like, oh, if there's something interesting, you'll tell me. And I don't know what to ask.
All right.
isn't that, well, I know nothing about this situation. Aren't you going to tell me the interesting things about this situation? How would I know what to ask is interesting when I don't know what the interesting thing is? You know what the interesting thing is.
Yeah, that's not really how journalism works, but yeah, okay.
No, this is not how journalism works, and it's also why I am not a journalist. Mm. But I just say again, every time we've ever discussed this, you disregard your interviewing skills because they just come so naturally to you. And for me, I'm panicked. I'm sitting here sweating, trying to think of a question to ask you as you're telling your story.
Okay, well, you don't have to panic.
I'm very sorry.
You just have to say what comes into your head.
Sometimes nothing comes into the head.
Well, it's... then so be it.
This episode of Hello Internet is also brought to you by Igloo. Igloo is an intranet you'll actually like. Igloo allows you to share news, organize your files, coordinate calendars, and manage projects all in one place. And Igloo's latest upgrade, Viking, revolves around documents and how you interact with them, gather feedback, and make changes. They've even added the ability to track who has read critical information to keep everyone on the same page. It's like read receipts in your email, but way less annoying, so that you can see who has read what or who has signed off on the necessary legal agreements or the completion of training materials. Most companies' intranets are terrible. I know I have used several terrible intranets that looked like they were built almost two decades ago now. If that's what your company is struggling with, you should definitely give Igloo a try. If you've never tried switching over your intranet software, you can definitely give Igloo a free try. In fact, their full product is available if your team size is under 10 users, so you can try it out with a small group before rolling it out to your main company if you want to. Or if your company is fewer than 10 people, you're all set. Now, go to igloosoftware.com/hello so that they know you came from us to give Igloo a try. Igloo, the internet you'll actually like.
Homework.
We mentioned last time The Martian as some homework to do. This episode is coming out relatively soon after the other one, so maybe not everybody has read it yet. I don't know.
For the record, everyone, I said to Gray that I thought it was too soon to be talking about the book The Martian a week after setting it as homework. But Gray insists we do it now.
I guess I'm sort of insisting. I am making you do this. Mm-hmm. But it's largely because I already read The Martian, I think from my perspective, 2.5 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago. And so I think I'm just going to forget the details if we wait any longer, because it might be a while until we record the next one. So I feel like the half-life of The Martian in my brain is quickly diminishing. So we have to talk about it now.
I do have some respect for that position, Gray, because I read it. I don't know when I read it. It must be 6 months, maybe even a year ago, around the time I recommended it on an Audible ad. And I have forgotten almost all of it. So I'm not going to be massively useful, although I have read it. So I'm across the book, but I won't have the kind of intimate knowledge of details that you will still have.
Oh, you're already overselling my position here.
Okay.
But I guess the bottom line for the listeners is, one, prepare yourself for spoilers from this point on, and two, prepare yourself for perhaps the worst and least detailed conversation of any homework assignment we have yet given.
Okay. Now, naturally, the first thing I want to know, right, and I know you've already got your little plan in place, so I'm not going to be able to shake you from it, but I am curious as to whether you liked it or not. Am I going to know that, or do I have to wait for that to be revealed over a series of sleight of hand grayisms?
You always want to jump right to the heart of the thing.
Yeah.
Why do you always want to do this?
Because I'm a journalist. It's an inverted pyramid, Gray. If the world ends before this conversation finishes, I'll never know if you like the book or not.
That doesn't make any sense to
me. I also think it gives a context to what you're saying, knowing if you liked the book or not. Like, it changes the grain of salt I'm taking mm-hmm. with what you say. But anyway, you do it how mm-hmm. you want. What do you want to say about this book? You set it as homework. You must have something you want to say.
So the reason that I wanted to set it as homework was, you know, I don't read a lot of fiction books normally. I tend to read mostly nonfiction. This is a case where a bunch of people in my life and a bunch of science-y people in my life as well all recommended this book. There was a bit of a universal wall of recommendation from people. So I thought, oh, you know what? Let me give this one a try. Mm-hmm. Even though, again, don't read a lot of fiction, but I thought, I've heard from people that I trust, not only that I should read this book, but also that they think I would like this book. Mm. So I thought, okay, I'm going to give it a try. Mm. This is the strange modern experience, but I bought it while sitting on the runway at Dulles Airport, waiting for my plane to take off to San Francisco. And I realized, oh, I need to get something to do on the airplane. And so I was able to just buy it on my iPad and have it download on the runway because I was being naughty and I hadn't turned off the data connection, even though they told me to.
Yep.
So it literally downloaded as the wheels were lifting off the ground.
Nice.
But, you know, you don't tell the flight attendants about that and it's okay.
All right.
This is the context. And so I started to read it on the airplane.
Yep.
If you want me to cut to the meat of it. Oh, sorry. That was an adorable little sound.
Oh, you heard that?
Just interrupted us.
That was the little noise Audrey makes as she's like nodding off.
That's so sweet. She can interrupt the podcast anytime she wants with that adorable noise.
She interrupted at a brilliant moment then, because you were just about to give us the verdict on the book. If you want me to cut, yeah. You said, if you want me to cut to the meat of it. Oh, and I was thinking, what does that mean? Does that mean he liked it or didn't like it? Because I didn't know you'd heard her.
No, that was absolutely adorable. Yeah, so what I would say is, if I'm going to cut to the heart of it, there is no way in the world I would ever have finished this book were it not for the fact that I was on an airplane.
Right.
And had limited options of other things to do.
Right.
So I wouldn't say that it was a bad book.
Yeah.
I don't feel the way about The Martian, say, the way you feel about Getting Things Done. But I
okay. This would be a long podcast if otherwise.
Yeah. I made a note about it, and the note at the top of my page was just meh. Was kind of the way I felt about the book, but I did have some specific complaints. But it was just an interesting experience reading it, because I could see why people would think that I would like this book, but it was actually probably those parts that most annoyed me about the book would be the things that people would think that I like the most.
I didn't think you'd like the book.
Oh, really? Mm. How interesting. Mm. Didn't you recommend it to me?
I don't know. Maybe I did, but I'm not surprised you don't like it.
Why are you not surprised?
I think this is going to more be about what you have to say about it. I did enjoy this book, right?
This seems like a Brady enjoyable book.
Yeah, I liked the book, but I liked it for a few specific reasons, and those reasons aren't because it was a good book. Mm-hmm. The Martian is a book that will be liked by people who don't read many good books. The Martian is a book for people who don't know what a good book is actually like, particularly science geeky people who don't read a lot of books or particularly who don't read a lot of fiction books and haven't got much to compare it to and just thinks it's awesome that a book has been written about Mars and modern science and almost the people who are almost blind cheerleaders for science and will just cheer the fact a science book has been written and has gone mainstream and it could have been written in Latin and in crayon and they wouldn't care because it's a science book that's gone mainstream and that means good, good, good.
Uh-huh.
So there's a lot of that going on, you know. if something science is in the mainstream, it must be good and we must be cheerleaders because we cheer everything science. And I find that a bit frustrating. Mm-hmm. And it's also not a particularly well-written book. You know, it's pretty basic. You know, it's not a brilliantly crafted book. And it's not full of many clever twists and turns plot-wise. It's just a pretty linear story. So that's the things that's wrong with it. There's a few things that are good about it, which I may talk about in a minute or may not, depending on where things go, and things I liked about it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, The Da Vinci Code is another example of a book that's not a particularly good book, but is very compelling to read. And I found The Martian a bit like that. I always had to read the next chapter because it had certain hooks through it that were very clever, much like The Da Vinci Code does.
Hmm.
And you can sit back and be sniffy about The Da Vinci Code and say, oh, it's not a good book. But when you're reading The Da Vinci Code, it's like heroin and you had to read the next chapter. And I found The Martian a bit like that. The Martian is a bit like, I cannot stop because I have to read the next chapter. And it's not because I can't wait to see what brilliant turn of phrase is going to be used. It's for other reasons. But
it's interesting to hear you say that you felt compelled to read it, because I did not feel that way at all.
Right.
And I was so close to putting down the book. So for those who haven't read it, this is no spoiler. It starts off straight away with the premise that a man has been left on Mars after a space expedition there, and a storm has forced the rest of his crew to retreat.
Yeah.
And it starts off as this first-person narrative, basically of him saying he's on Mars and he's screwed and he's injured, and how is he going to try and survive on the planet?
Yeah.
Which is a good premise for a book, right? Mm-hmm. It's a compelling story about a man trying to survive.
Yeah. It's sort of Castaway in space.
Perfect. That's how you would pitch the movie. That might very well be how the movie was pitched. It's Castaway in space. And we should come back to the movie trailer later. But I'm reading it, and the first seven chapters are all told from the first person perspective of this guy.
Mm-hmm.
And
Mark Watney is the hero.
So I found the first two chapters, I'm like, oh, okay, this is an interesting premise. It's good so far. But after about chapter two, all I could think of as I'm reading this book was technobabble on Star Trek.
Mm.
And in Star Trek, they always have technobabble, which boils down to someone says something is broken. And then another person has a made-up series of nonsense words about how they're going to fix whatever the thing is.
Mm.
And it just always feels like, can we just move past this? Like, why does this always have to be the plot point of made-up problem, made-up solution, neither of which matters? It just matters that the thing got fixed.
I don't remember thinking that, to be fair, in the book. I do remember getting fatigued by the number of things that break and then get fixed. It's a bit like, okay, here we go again. But I never remember thinking, oh, that would never happen and that solution seems fudged. I always thought, well, that probably would happen on Mars and that probably is a way you could fix it. So I found it a bit repetitive in that sense, I don't remember thinking technobabble.
This is why I think people would think that I'd like it, because they're plausible solutions. He's actually talking about actual things. So I have a little segment here that's highlighted as a passage from the book where he says, I need to ration my EVAs as well as food. The CO2 filters are not cleanable. Once they're saturated, they're done. The mission accounted for a 4-hour EVA per crew per member per day. Fortunately, CO2 filters are light and small. All told, I have about 1,500 hours of CO2 filters. After that, and then he goes on and on with this description about all of the equipment.
Yeah.
And I find it kind of frustrating because it's almost like it's written as though it's a real story, but I can't get past the fact that everything in it is made up, right? That the author is providing the character with a certain number of air filters that he's going to be able to get through, or like descriptions of machines that have to be connected, basically Apollo 13 style, right? Of, oh, we have this square peg to fit in this round hole.
Mm.
But I'm just constantly aware of the author as creator of problems for which the character Mark is going to give me far too detailed descriptions of how to fix them. And I just found it really, really tedious in the first seven chapters.
I did feel sometimes, sort of talking to that point, but from a slightly different angle, I thought again, my memory is not as good as yours because it was a longer time ago, but I thought the problem there was more a case of the author was trying to justify everything. Like he was trying to show that he'd done the math to show that this is what would happen. It's a bit like, okay, you don't need to prove to me that that he has this many filters for this reason because this and that, and this is what would have happened if the disaster hadn't struck. It was a bit like, all right, okay, man, it's all right. You know, like you've done your homework. I know you've done your homework. It doesn't mean you have to show me all you're working out.
Exactly. I'm randomly flipping through the book on my computer, and I just stopped at another sentence. To be viable, soil needs 40 liters of water per cubic meter. My overall plan calls for 9.2 cubic meters of soil, so I'll eventually need 368 liters of water. And it's like, God damn it, dude. Like, I don't need all of this. It is just too much. And I'm flipping through pages, and the number of two pages over, right? This is like several paragraphs after the thing that I just read you. In 62 square meters, I could grow maybe 150 kilograms of potatoes in 400 days. That's a grand total of 1,150 calories, a sustainable average of 200. It's like, it just flip, flip, flip. I flip over to the next page. Okay, there's numbers all over that page. I flip over to the next page. There's numbers on this page. Flip over. There's no numbers on this page, finally. Oh, no, there is. There's a number 106 in the middle. I'm flipping over again. There are at least 20 numbers on this page. Mm. And it's just forever. I almost don't know why, like, I made it through this first section. But I was at whatever it was, chapter 6. And I said to myself in my head, if the next chapter is like this, I'm just going to stop. Like, I'm not going to go any further because I cannot stand this. And perhaps unfortunate for me, again, not like I didn't like the book, but I could have done something better with my time on the flight. The very next chapter is where it finally switches perspective and it goes to NASA headquarters and them trying to figure out what has happened. Mm. And so I thought, okay, book, I'm going to give you a little bit more time because maybe you just wanted to establish all of this. But for me, it was unfortunate because there was just enough of the other stuff that I ended up feeling like I'm going to keep finishing this book. But all things told, I would rather have read a different book than this book. But yeah, I just found almost all of the sections where Mark is talking about his solutions to the problems just way over tedious. And I think you're right. It's like someone who's very, very eager to show you all of their work. It actually reminds me of back when I was in college. I had a job doing research for one of the professors, and for various reasons, at some point we went to Washington, D.C., where we had to present to some Congress people what our research projects were and what we were working on. And I'll never forget that the professor told me before we went into some of these meetings, he wanted to impress the fact of your day may be filled with all of the details of what you're working on, and that's what's on the top of your mind. But when you're talking to somebody else, don't tell the congressperson about the details that seem important to you. You have to think about what he might be interested in. What are the practical results of this research, you know, or why the funding should continue. But you don't want to talk about how hard it is to do all of this research and the complicated data analysis spreadsheet you had to use for high energy frequency plasmas. This does feel like it's just too much. Like, there's a way to move the story forward without having all of the details.
He showed you too much detail of how the sausage was made, and it put you off the sausage.
If this was a book about a real event that had occurred, I may find those details much more interesting. But again, it's just like, it's just the fabricated nature of it. And I have a note here where I wrote, made up solutions to made up problems, and then in brackets, obviously, that's every book, but this just bothered me for some reason. I can't quite put my finger on why, but it really did bother me, and I found it rather tedious.
Was there anything redeeming about the book for you?
Oh, I have more things to complain about, but I was going to ask if there were other things you like about the book.
What do I like about the book?
Yeah, what do you like about the book?
I do like the nostalgia. I do like, spoiler alert,
nostalgia.
I do like that they use previous historic NASA missions and equipment that has landed on the planet nearby to save the day.
That was, I have to say, that was the best part. That was nice. Absolutely the best part.
So I liked that.
Yeah, he uses one of the previous crashed missions on Mars to contact. Maybe it was Sojourner. I don't remember exactly. But I have to say, when that development happened in the book, I thought, ooh, that's very clever. That's a good way to do things.
So I liked that. But I think the biggest strength of the book from memory is, and you perhaps don't feel this way by the sounds of it, but I think it's the likability of the main character. I don't know if it was skill or luck, but I think the way that Mark Watney, the main character, was written appealed to me. I liked him. I liked that he was funny and had a sense of humor. Like, I found him funny. Like, because obviously the first part of the book is him writing a journal, he's keeping like a log, isn't he? That people will probably find after he's died, he suspects, but he keeps a journal. And I think I think the personality of this main character, I really liked him, and I liked that he had a little bit of a rebel streak to authority through him. And I think he is what made me care. The reason I cared about the book is because I liked him and I cared about what happened to him. I felt a relationship with him. And I actually thought whenever they went back to NASA or they went back to the other spacecraft that's heading back to Earth, the people that have left him behind, I found all of that completely boring because there were no characters there I cared about. There was no one I liked. And I thought that was all quite perfunctory and it wasn't very believable to me. It just felt like any old book. But I thought Mark Watney, the character, I liked him. I thought he was cool. I wanted to be his friend. He's smart and he's funny and he's joking around, but he's resourceful. And there are all those problems with the way things were written, and there's all that tedious detail to get through about liters of water and spreading dirt. Mm-hmm. But I liked the guy and I wanted him to somehow get out of this problem. And that's what kept me going. I just wanted to know whether or not my mate was going to get out of it or not.
Mm-hmm. Of course, I'm the reverse here, where I found the sections where they switched the narrative to NASA and everybody running the mission as like a relief in the book. Yeah. I thought, oh boy, I want to find out if this team of people can pull off this mission and what are they going to do? Mm-hmm. Which again is kind of ridiculous because that is also a made up problem that they're coming up with made up solutions for. But I found that the details whenever they were talking about the NASA section were at a more appropriate level. And I enjoyed those sections much better.
Well, the detail may be true, but I thought the people were, I can't even remember any of them. I can't remember. I can remember the captain of the ship, I think, but I can't remember any of the other characters. They were completely just went by me like bland nobodies.
Yes. But I have a note here that I was laughing at when you were describing your lack of the main character, because I wrote, does anyone find this funny? ?? Because this was my other main bullet point, which is, do you read any Stephen King books?
Well, I'm listening to one at the moment, but I haven't read a lot. I've read two or three, maybe.
I knew you were listening to the JFK one, but you haven't read a bunch of his books.
Definitely not a bunch.
Okay.
No.
A thing that I kept thinking when I was reading this is there's a certain kind of humor which I find in books, which I felt that this character, Mark Watney, had, which to me just seems like saying silly things. And I find no humor in this at all. And I like Stephen King quite a lot. But one thing that really irritates me when I read lots of his books is when he wants to have a funny character, it reads the exact same way as the Mark Watney character in this book reads. Of Stephen King will have a character say a silly thing. And it does not register with me at all. It does not move the humor needle at all. And I just find it an extraordinarily grating personality.
Yeah.
So all of the sections where he's making jokes is just none of that registers. And I would be the annoyed guy at NASA. Like, can we move along here? You know, we have something to do.
Well, great. That's just you. I mean, your humor needle is not always the easiest thing to move anyway.
There's lots of written stuff that I find funny, but this just seemed another incarnation of this same way that when an author wants to make a character funny, I feel like the characters are always funny in the same way, where they're really just silly or wacky. And I highlighted, this was almost at the very end of the book, but I highlighted the one passage that really put me over the edge in terms of this kind of joke.
Yeah.
Like, NASA's asking him if he needs anything. And he says, If I could have anything, it would be a radio to ask NASA for a safe path down the ramp. Well, if I could have anything, it would be a green-skinned, beautiful Queen of Mars to rescue me so she can learn more about this Earth thing called lovemaking. And I just feel like it's not funny. It's just silly. It's like... That one was just like, it just, I groaned out loud, I think, on the airplane.
I can't remember that one. The way you read it certainly didn't make me
feel. I'm not giving him any favors, yeah, with the way I'm reading it.
I don't
it.
Know. That kind of gallows humor. I don't know. I imagine I would be like that. Confronted with that situation, I would have that kind of gallows humor. He, mm-hmm. I mean, he was definitely corny. He was definitely like making dad
jokes.
Yeah,
corny is a good way to put it.
But that was his personality. And like when he started having email contact or text contact back with NASA, and he starts making like silly jokes to him, and they tell him to be serious. Like that's just what he's like. He's like, he's a corny dude, and he's like a cornball. But that is a personality trait. I know cornball, corny people, and some of them are my friends and I like them. And I would not describe them as like comedy geniuses, but I like them. And that cornball, corny joke nature to him and that gallows humor he keeps using isn't the only part of his personality, but I don't know. He just seemed like a real character to me. And whether you'd like a character or don't like a character, if a character seems real, I find that quite compelling. And I feel like, for whatever reason, I remember thinking when I was reading it, like Watney just seemed like a real guy to me. I did kind of like him, but also more importantly, I believed he was real. And therefore I wanted him to live. And all those NASA people were just cardboard cutouts sitting at computers and analyzing data and thinking. And even the people in the ship were kind of caricatures. Oh, I feel so guilty. We made a mistake. We must go back.
Yes, I will agree with you there. I mean, even though I enjoyed the sections where they're talking about the astronauts who are currently in space, aside from the captain, I kept being aware of, I don't know how many other people are on this ship. Or just I'm confused with the dialogue because, yes, there were no distinct characters there whatsoever. And I think, oh, I like the NASA sections better. But casting my mind back, I have just vague recollections of there's a director. And there's like a pushy PR person,
and there's the hardworking woman who made the breakthrough.
It's very hard to come up with anything in particular. But you're totally right with the corny, and this is just a personality difference because you mentioned, for example, dad humor, and I have always thought, but what is it that happens to men where it seems like once they have a child, there's some chemical shift in their brain where now puns are the height of humor. And I've never found a pun funny, but I have definitely seen men all of a sudden after having a baby shift into this bizarre dad humor. And I really think it's some kind of biological shift. I wonder if I were to have a baby, would I suddenly think that puns are punny? Right? Because they're not. That kind of stuff drives me crazy. And yes, this sort of humor was along those lines. So it's why I would be much, much more resistant to it. Yeah, I'm not a big fan of that stuff. But sidebar, is there a biological change in men when they have children about the humor they like? I demand answers. Someone's PhD in neuroscience needs to be on this topic.
All right, so thumbs down from Gray. I'm giving it a thumbs up. It's not a masterpiece. It's just... the other thing is it's easy as pie to read. That's the other reason. It's like a hot knife through butter reading that book. It's a real page. You're not sitting there being challenged in any way. And that was always helpful.
That may definitely contribute to why it is a more popular book. I mean, I have to say, I'm always very happy to see anybody who starts off as self-published as this author was achieve phenomenal success. I always like that. Yeah. So easy to read definitely goes along with that and helps grease the wheels. The only other thing I did want to talk about was just the movie a little bit.
Yeah. How did you... I guess you didn't go through this experience that I did because I read the book before the movie was announced. I was going to say, how did you feel when you heard that Matt Damon was going to be Mark Watney?
Two things here. The first was when I decided I'm going to buy The Martian and give it a try. When I went to buy it, the cover is a big picture of Matt Damon's face. And this is always something that drives me crazy with books. Like, yeah. I've never, ever, you know, when I used to buy a lot of books. I'm sitting in a room right now with a whole bunch of books that have been collected over my lifetime, my parents' lifetime. And I would never, ever, ever buy the movie version of the book.
Yeah.
I can only assume that they sell well because they always come out. But yeah. I personally hate them. And I'm always suspicious of the kind of reader who would buy the movie cover of the book.
I'm totally with you on that one, Gray.
Yeah. And I had a thought, which if anybody at Apple is listening, I was looking at this thing and I thought, this is an electronic book. It's not a real book. Why can't I select the cover that I want to have in my library? Why do I have to have Matt Damon's face looking at me? If this is not a physical object anymore, I should be able to select whatever the first edition cover was. But no, Matt Damon was there. And it was almost enough to make me not buy the book, but I did overcome at the last second to get it just as the wheels were lifting off.
Matt Damon.
But it did also cause the problem as I was reading the book. I kept thinking, Matt Damon? Is he this character remotely? I don't think so.
I mean, I can imagine that would have really affected how much I liked Mark Watney. And like, I mean, Matt Damon does some all right stuff and he does some rubbish and you know, you can think what you want about him, but I did have a blank slate for my Mark Watney. And if I had Matt Damon preloaded as Mark Watney, I might not be saying quite the nice things about him that I am. Or maybe, I don't know. I'll never know because I can't do it again. But
yeah, I don't have strong feelings about Matt Damon one way or the other. So it's not like, oh, I don't or do really like him.
Yeah.
I just, at a few times I thought, because of the humor, I thought, I have a hard time imagining Matt Damon do this.
Yeah.
But I didn't feel like Matt Damon was in my brain as I was reading the book because I thought these characters seem so different.
Okay.
He seems like a very strange casting choice for this person.
Yeah.
But so I always knew that the movie was out. And just before we started recording this podcast, I thought, oh, I want to watch the trailer because I'd seen some people talking about it when it first came out. And the trailer is perhaps the most magnificently spoiler-tastic trailer I have ever seen. It was astounding. I mean, the trailer is whatever it is, 2 or 3 minutes long, but it hits every single plot point in the whole book.
Yeah.
I was amazed.
I'm trying to remember, actually. I have watched it a few times, and I do remember I showed it to my wife because she knew that I enjoyed the book. And I said, oh, they're making it into a film. Let's watch the trailer together. And I think we watched it twice. Like, I do remember being struck by the quantity of spoilers in it. I do agree with your observation. But do you mind if I look at it?
Do you want to watch it again?
Yeah, I do. Let me watch it.
You watch it right now.
I'm watching it.
Okay, you watch it. I'm going to watch it again as well.
It is a good trailer. If you ignore spoiler issues, it does make you think, I want to go and see the film. I watched it, Gray.
So you just watched the trailer again?
I watched it. There was one thing I thought they didn't spoil, but I'm wrong. They did spoil it.
All of the major plot points, the trailer hits.
Yeah.
Which, if you're listening to us talk now, we're assuming that you're okay with spoilers. But it's the storm that comes. His hab has an explosion. He finds the probe. He communicates with NASA. NASA comes up with a plan to rescue him. The astronauts already in space decide to do a mutiny and turn their spaceship around. And they show the final takeoff where he is rescued from Mars. It was just amazing.
They even have a shot showing like the number on the wall, how many days he's been alive and things like that as well. It's almost deliberate.
You know what? There are so many spoilers. It didn't even cross my mind that showing him writing 461 on the wall is also a massive spoiler on how long is he going to survive. It's amazing.
I will say this, though. If you hadn't read the book, a lot of those spoilers would have been lost on you. That is true. Like, you would have the takeoff. You probably couldn't have clocked that was him taking off from Mars somehow. You could easily have missed that. You wouldn't have clocked that was the old NASA probe that he was rubbing the dust off and using to get back in touch with Earth. You definitely wouldn't have picked up on that if you didn't know the book or you weren't very au fait with Martian history. So in some ways, the spoiler is only spoiling it for people who've read the book anyway, and it's telling us what things have made it and what hasn't. I don't think it shows him flipping his vehicle, which was a big moment in the book as well, wasn't it? When he's driving long distances and he
flips. Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I don't think they show that, but maybe they hadn't filmed that yet, so they couldn't cram that in.
It might not be in there. But I will just say again that at least for me, when I watch these trailers, what I mean by spoilers is even if I don't know what the thing is, like I'm very aware of shots like, oh, there's a different spaceship taking off. And when I'm watching the movie, my brain just has a little checklist of all of the shots that we saw in a trailer and is ticking them off. And I've been in movies so many times where I'm just sitting there and my brain is thinking, oh, there's two things in the trailer we haven't seen yet. We haven't seen him go up to a pile of robotic stuff, and we haven't seen that second spaceship. So I'm just waiting. Mm. And I hate that so much. So yeah, even if you don't know what's going on, it's still spoilers.
I haven't got your memory for trailers, so I don't have quite the same problem, but...
You are lucky.
You're right. And that trailer is basically the whole film from start to finish.
Yes, you know, it really is.
The only thing they don't rule out is that at the last second he dies because of some mishap in the transfer or something. But
they didn't show him back on Earth. That could have been.
Yeah, lying by a lake having a drink.
Right. Yeah, tousling his kid's hair or whatever. That's the way Anna Hollywood would want to end the movie. My final thought on this, though, is watching the trailer, I thought, this is going to make a way better movie than a book. There are times when books are turned into movies that are superior than them. Hmm. And watching the trailer, I thought, oh, I bet this is going to be a much, much more enjoyable movie than the book.
Meh.
Because I think the movie is going to force it to cut down on the technobabble a little bit.
Yeah.
And seeing Matt Damon playing the character, I thought, okay, he's just playing a character, but it doesn't necessarily have to be exactly like the guy in the book. Mm. He can just be a slightly wisecracking astronaut, and it's much more palatable sometimes on film.
A bit more Jason Bourne, a bit less
exactly.
Mark Watney.
Exactly. He can be more Jason Bourne and less Mark Watney. Mm. And so that was my conclusion, was I thought, this is probably going to be a movie that is way more enjoyable and successful than the book is.
That's my prediction. I think the movie will be poorer for not having that initial written log. And I think there's something quite special about the transition from him only being able to write to then being able to, you know, text and that. And I think turning it into a vlog, which is what they're going to do, because they have to, because of the medium.
They have to do it, yes.
I think that's a loss. I think something's lost there, but I don't know. I'm always a bit worried about Martian films because I always have high hopes for films about Mars, and they so often disappoint. Mission to Mars, for me, remains the worst film ever made in the history of movies.
Yes.
Although that is a bit of a Maryland flag, that film, because whenever it's on TV, I will watch it because it's so bad, it wraps around on itself and I enjoy the badness of it. So I've watched that film way more than I've watched some films I love. But but Martian films very often miss the mark. So let's hope this one's okay.
Mm-hmm. Those are mostly my final thoughts.
You're going to disappoint a few people that really loved the book, because when you set it as homework, a few people got pretty excited because they love the book so much. So you're going to disappoint a few people there, but you've got to call it. You've got to call it as you see it, Gray.
Yeah. And my disappointment for things shouldn't affect how other people feel about things. It's not relevant.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if they read the book and they enjoyed it, I hope they did.
Yeah,
I would never wish a bad experience on anybody. I would hope that they enjoyed the book, but you know, we have to complain about something on the podcast.
Yeah,
that's that's how this works.
Yep. All right, there we go. The Martian. Yet again, we have recommended a book for homework, and then when the time comes to discuss it, one of us has absolutely slammed it and thought it was a waste of time to read it.
Yeah, I still say, not awful, but I would have rather read almost anything else.
They're not going to put that on the cover, are they? Not awful, but I would rather have read almost anything else. CGP Grey, hello internet.